I'm Bruce Gewirtz, Surgeon-in-Chief and Vice Dean for Academic Affairs, and we're fortunate enough today to have Dr. Paul Noble, our Distinguished Professor and Chair of Medicine. Paul, welcome.
Thank you, Bruce.
Tell us a little bit about your background. Where did you grow up, go to school?
Sure. I grew up in the Midwest, in the great state of Michigan. My dad was in surgical sales. We moved around a fair amount. I went to high school in New York State and college outside of Philadelphia. And then I went to medical school in New York City at NYU, and then migrated west for my internal medicine residency at the University of California, San Francisco, and became interested in pulmonary medicine and did my pulmonary fellowship at the University of Colorado and the National Jewish Center.
So what was it about lung diseases that interested you?
Well, initially I thought I was really going to be a rheumatologist. During medical school, I worked in a research lab for a very prominent rheumatologist and became very interested in inflammation. And when I went out to San Francisco, and took care of patients with autoimmune diseases, when they got really sick, had alveolar hemorrhage, or needed to go to the intensive care unit, I realized I really loved taking care of sick patients in the intensive care unit, and ended up deciding to go into pulmonary and critical care medicine. And it was during my time at UCSF that I became interested really in my lifelong passion, which has been why the lungs form scar tissue. During my time there, we had started a bone marrow transplant program. And during my chief resident year, I reviewed all the pulmonary complications because I was struck that a number of patients were succumbing to what looked like a fibrotic lung disease without infection. And we did autopsies on those. And I became very interested in this question of why the lung forms scar tissue. And then when I went to the University of Colorado, they have a very prominent interstitial lung disease program. And at the time, it was an extraordinary place to be. And I really became smitten with these diseases that cause chronic inflammation and scarring in the lungs. And I've been trying to track down the causes and help patients who suffer with these problems for the last 2.5 decades.
So we know that the lungs allow you to take oxygen from the air and saturate your blood with it. What is it about the fibrosis that prevents the diffusion of oxygen into the bloodstream?
So interstitial lung disease is sort of a fancy term, but really what it boils down is to the area in between the small bronchioles and the capillaries. And that's exactly right. That's where gas exchange happens. And what happens in these chronic fibrosing lung diseases is that interstitial or in-between space, which is usually a virtual space, becomes filled with stuff. When it's filled with inflammation, many times we can make those patients better. But for reasons we don't fully understand, some patients go on to form a scar tissue there, and it's progressive and oftentimes irreversible. And it's been our goal to try to better understand what the mechanisms are that lead to this process, because patients, in essence, can't get oxygen into their blood when they exert themselves.
So how common is pulmonary fibrosis, say, in comparison to other lung diseases like emphysema and other chronic obstructive pulmonary disease?
So pulmonary fibrosis is much less common than emphysema or asthma, but it's more common than diseases that perhaps are more prominent, like cystic fibrosis or even pulmonary hypertension. We think there are about 40 or 50,000 new patients each year that suffer from fibrosing lung diseases, and we think there are probably in the order of 1 or 200,000 in terms of a prevalence. So it's uncommon, but not rare.
So what is the trigger for this inflammation? Does anybody know, or have you found out in your research?
So it depends on the underlying etiology. There's sort of four reasons why your lungs can form scar tissue. One can be medications. The classic ones are things that called amiodarone, which are used to treat tachyarrhythmias of the heart, or a medication used to treat chronic urinary tract infections called nitrofurantoin. These medications form scar tissue, and when we stop them and we give an anti-inflammatory agent, we can usually get patients better. Then there's a broad group of fibrosing lung disease that occur in the context of autoimmune diseases. The famous ones are like rheumatoid arthritis and scleroderma, but there are a number of less common autoimmune diseases, Sjogren's, mixed connective tissue disease, the antisynthetase syndrome, that have chronic inflammation and go on to scarring. Now, the caveat here is that this is driven by a dysregulated immune system. And many times we use medications that target the immune system, and we can slow down and occasionally even reverse the fibrosis. The other big category where we have a known etiology is something called chronic hypersensitivity pneumonitis. This is something you breathe in the air. The classic scenario are patients who have parakeets or cockatiels or finches. These birds can cause chronic lung diseases. Molds, when there's water damage to the house, mold forms in the walls. These spores can then get into the lungs and form chronic inflammation and fibrosis. The last category, and we see a lot of this in California, are feathers, down feathers in particular, down comforters. Exposure to down for years and years can lead to this chronic fibrosing lung disease. Most of the time, not all of the time, but about 75% of the time, if we can get rid of the underlying agent, sometimes it's challenging in people who have birds. They become very attached to them. But if we can get rid of the birds and use judicious immunosuppressive therapies, we can often halt it and most of the time prevent the need for patients to go on with advanced lung diseases. But the last category, and the one that's the most challenging and the most severe, is when we can't figure out why it's there. It's called idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis.
I know there are parts of the country that this occurs more frequently.
So it's interesting. In California, of course, we don't get a lot of rain. But in the southeast and other parts of the country where there's a lot of rain and you have water damage, you can get the chronic hypersensitivity pneumonitis. In my experience out here at Cedars-Sinai for the last 7 years, I've seen more cases of chronic hypersensitivity pneumonitis than I saw during times on the East Coast. And I think it has something to do with our air. I think the spores, are more comfortable in the ambient air that we have here. But as a general rule, these diseases afflict all parts of the country.
If someone found that in the morning they woke up and they had a stuffy nose or difficulty breathing and it got better during the day, would that be indicative of this?
So that is a salient point about the diagnosis. Patients, what I will often ask them is, when you go on vacation, if you're gone from the house for maybe 1 or 2 weeks, do you feel better? And that can be a telltale sign or symptom that there's something in the home environment. The challenge is that up to half the time, we can't find the culprit. And so that makes it very, very difficult. The other thing in the environment can be buildings. There's something called a sick building syndrome. Sometimes buildings have mold and things along those lines, and it's important to investigate that.
Are there genetic predeterminants that might increase your risk of developing some form of pulmonary fibrosis?
So there is a familial form of pulmonary fibrosis, and there are some genetic abnormalities, particularly in the genes called the telomerases. These are genes that are sort of anti-aging. And patients who have mutations in this category of genes are predisposed to pulmonary fibrosis. And there are a couple of other known genetic abnormalities. What the lung does and the specific cells that are involved, they make something called surfactant. That allows us to take a deep breath. And these cells that make surfactant, there can be mutations in some of the genes of these surfactant genes. And that leads to the dysfunction in these stem cells. There are also some other polymorphisms that we don't fully understand.
What is the most common age that people start to experience symptoms of pulmonary fibrosis?
So in patients who have idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, it's generally a disease that affects men more often than women, extremely unusual under the age of 50. It rises dramatically with age. And these patients all have the same symptoms. They get out of breath when they exert themselves. They feel like they're just getting older, and they have this dry, irritating cough. One of the biggest challenges we face, it often takes 1 to 2 years before patients come to medical attention because these symptoms are so vague, and they're often attributed to heart disease or, if they smoked, emphysema. And patients, the delay to the time of diagnosis is one of the biggest obstacles we face.
Well, that brings us to the diagnosis. How is it that you specifically diagnose pulmonary fibrosis?
So it's very key to take that careful history to exclude an autoimmune disease, a cause, a medication. And then when we can't find a cause, our evaluation centers around what we call the high-resolution chest CAT scan. These are thin section slices that allow us to have a very, very sensitive view of the lung tissue. And there's a particular pattern we look for. It's all about patterns with imaging, and there's a particular pattern that we see that it, we call honeycombing. It looks like a beehive cut on end, and when we see this, that is very indicative of the type of scarring we have. There are other forms that we can see as well that are much more treatable.
So would this be evident on a routine chest X-ray?
So a chest X-ray, unfortunately, is relatively unhelpful. For two reasons. One is the radiologist will often read this as chronic interstitial fibrosis, and that doesn't set off alarm bells that this is a major medical condition. In fact, patients who suffer from idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis have a 5-year mortality that approaches many cancers. And if there's a chest X-ray that has a pulmonary nodule, it's a medical emergency. But unfortunately, because of this disease is not as well known as it should be, it leads to delay in diagnosis. And the key thing about the X-ray is when it's abnormal, you need to get the high-resolution chest CAT scan.
So if you detect this relatively early, before the patient is debilitated, what are the best treatments?
So the last decade, and particularly in 2014, there were the first two FDA-approved drugs to treat patients who have idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis. I had the good fortune to be involved in the trials that led to that FDA approval. So when we make the diagnosis with the high-resolution CAT scan, our careful history laboratory evaluation, occasionally still we need to use our valued colleagues in thoracic surgery to do a surgical lung biopsy. We don't do that as often as we used to because of the sophistication in the high-resolution CAT scan. But when we're not sure, we still like biopsies. So once we have a confident diagnosis, we have two therapies to offer. Both of these therapies have been shown to slow the loss of lung function. But the critical point, which you really hit on, is early diagnosis. Because to date, neither of these medications reverse the fibrosis. The lung function is not improved. We just slow the loss. Somewhat like in a tumor when you slow the growth of a tumor. So it's really incumbent upon us to diagnose patients at the earliest stages where they have the most preserved lung function, because once you lose that lung function, you really don't get it back.
You know, I know you've done a tremendous amount of research, and you and your team are really focused on this on a daily basis. What are the promising lines of treatment that might change the natural history of this disease?
We think there are two major problems that lead to the development of idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis. One is, I alluded to these cells that make this surfactant. It appears as though these alveolar type 2 cells, they're called, and they function as the stem cell in the distal lung, the distal alveolar space. They fail to regenerate properly. And over the last several years, our research laboratory here at Cedars and a number of others around the country have developed the ability to isolate these cells when patients undergo a lung transplant. So we can isolate these cells and we can set up these what we call organoid assays where they try to form lungs. And the normal type 2 cells can form this lung tissue. But the type 2 cells from these patients who have IPF cannot. So one focus is to try to understand, what are the missing pieces? What are the nutrients that are missing to try to identify ways to promote the regeneration? But the two approved therapies, they really treat the second half of the problem. When these type 2 cells die, what happens is the surrounding fibrous tissue, mesenchymal cells, are what we call fibroblasts. It's like when you cut yourself, you get that scab and you get that scar. So in idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, it's like a scar that doesn't stop healing. And the fibrosis continues. And what these medications do is they slow the ability of these cells to make collagen. Collagen is like jello, and the lungs sort of fill up with jello. So our current therapies really slow down the process. And there are a number of clinical trials that are involved to target both aspects of the lung regeneration, but also other ways to target these cells. Our own work has shown that there's a subset of these cells that we can isolate again from the patients who've had lung transplant that we think drive the disease process. It's a small percentage, but when we've been able to make it more difficult for these cells to function, in particular, they invade tissue. When we can block this function in animal models and now in a humanized model, we can stop the fibrosis and potentially reverse it. So the therapies that are under investigation in phase two, phase three trials, and some work that we're also beginning to have some early phase one trials in, our hope over the next 5 years are to identify medications that can actually reverse the process. Make people walk further, breathe better, and improve their quality of life.
So I know that lung transplant is one final option for these patients. What percentage of patients in general would progress to being a candidate for lung transplant?
So for patients with advanced pulmonary fibrosis, lung transplant is the only treatment that has been shown to prolong survival. The challenge is that in patients who have idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis, many of them are over the age of 70. Many of them also have other comorbid diseases. So unfortunately, only a minority of patients are candidates for lung transplant. And lung transplant of the solid organ transplants is the one that does have the most challenging outcomes because the lung is in contact with the environment. Unlike the kidney, liver, heart that are protected by the body, the lung is still in contact with the environment. And unfortunately, that leads to rejection more often than in the other organ transplants. But it remains a vital, vital part of the treatment plan. And patients can have long-term outcomes, return to work, great quality of life.
Well, Paul, I know that nationally and internationally, you're one of the most respected authorities in this disease. What are you optimistic about over the next 10 years?
So I think what I'm most optimistic about is that a lot of the technologies that are being developed to study cancers, specific cancer cells in particular, technologies have been developed where we can understand what a single cell is doing. And these therapies are being used in genetic diseases, in certain cancers. And our hope, really, what gets me out of the bed in the morning and makes me so excited, is that if we can really understand the critical pathways that drive these cells that lead to progression, that we can reverse the process.
Well, thank you very much for a terrific discussion, and we really appreciate the great work that you're doing here at Cedars-Sinai.
My pleasure.